Audible is the leading provider of spoken word entertainment and audiobooks, ranging from bestsellers to celebrity memoirs, news, business, and self-development. Every month, members get one credit to pick any title, plus two Audible originals from a monthly selection, and access to daily news digests from the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, and the Washington Post, as well as guided meditation programs. Between a full-time job in IT and a full-time job in podcasting, it gets harder and harder to sit down and read the books I'm interested in. This is where Audible comes in. I can listen on my daily commute, relaxing, or while out running errands and still get in the books I have been wanting to get into. You can download titles and listen offline anytime, anywhere. The app is free and can be installed on all smartphones and tablets. Now you can try Audible risk-free with a special 30-day free trial by visiting audibletrial.com/nerderyandmurdery. That's audibletrial.com/nerderyandmurdery. Don't let your busy life get in the way of that great book you've been wanting to read. Go get your free trial of Audible today. This podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp. This is Jeffrey, and we've talked about many times before that I experience problems and struggles with my mental health. And really, without a healthy mind, being truly happy and at peace is hard. The good news is therapy does work. It's helped for me. But what is therapy exactly? It's whatever you want it to be. Maybe you're not feeling motivated right now and would like some tools to help. Or maybe you're feeling insecure in relationships at work, or you're not dealing well with stress. Whatever you need, it's really time to stop being ashamed of normal human struggles, and it's time to start feeling better because you deserve to be happy. And now you don't have to worry about finding an in-person therapist near you to help. BetterHelp is a customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. It's much more affordable than in-person therapy, and you can start communicating with your therapist in under 48 hours. So join the millions of people who are seeing what online therapy is really about. It's always a good time to invest in yourself because you are your greatest asset. And there's a special offer to Nerdery and Murdery listeners. You can get 10% off your first month of professional therapy at betterhelp.com/nerderyandmurdery. That's betterhelp.com/nerderyandmurdery. Thanks again to BetterHelp for sponsoring this podcast.
I'm just a bill. Yes, I'm only a bill. And I'm sitting here on Capitol Hill.
Yeah.
You know what we're doing today?
Schoolhouse Rock, baby.
Sweet. I am Zig with your Just Nerdery, and again, a special guest star, the Internery K3.
Yay, it's Kimothy!
All right, so today for Just Nerdery Episode 2, we're going to talk about Schoolhouse Rock.
Yeah, everybody knows Schoolhouse Rock, and if you don't, what rock have you been living under? Because it's not the same one.
Very nice point. We probably ought to start with talking about what Saturday morning cartoons were, because there's a whole group of people who don't know. Saturday morning cartoons is a colloquial term for the original animated series and live action programs that were typically scheduled on Saturday and Sunday mornings in the United States on the big three television networks. The genre's popularity had a broad peak in the mid-60s through the mid-90s. Over time, it declined in the face of changing cultural norms, increased competition from formats available at all times, and heavier regulations. In the last two decades of the genre's existence, Saturday morning and Sunday morning cartoons were primarily created and aired to meet regulations on children's television programming in the United States, or EI, minor television networks. In addition to the non-commercial PBS, in some markets continue to air animated programs on Saturday and Sunday, while partially meeting those mandates. So how it broke down is in the United States, the generally accepted times for these and other children's programs to air on Saturday mornings were from 8 a.m. to approximately 1 p.m. Eastern time zones, which we're in Central, so it would have been 7 to noon. Until the late 1970s, American networks also had a schedule of children's programmings on Sunday mornings. Their most programs at this time were repeats of Saturday morning shows that were already out of production. In some markets, some shows were preempted in favor of syndicated or other types of local programming. Saturday morning and Sunday morning cartoons were largely discontinued in Canada by 2002. And in the United States, the CW continued to air non-EI, or educational information cartoons, as late as 2014. Among the big three traditional major networks, the final non-EI cartoon to date, Kim Possible, last aired in 2006.
Remember watching that one?
Yeah. Kelsey was obsessed with Kim Possible when she was little. Although the Saturday morning time slot had always featured a great deal of children's television beginning in the early 50s, the idea of commissioning new animated series for broadcast on Saturday mornings caught on in the mid 60s when the networks realized that they could concentrate kids viewing on that one morning to appeal to advertisers, notably manufacturers of toys and breakfast cereals. Furthermore, limited animation such as produced by such studios as Filmation, DePatie Freleng Enterprises, Total Television, Jay Ward Productions, and Hanna-Barbera were economical enough to produce in sufficient quantities to fill the five-hour block of time, as compared to live-action programming. While production times and costs were undeniably higher with animated programs, the cost of talent was far less. Voice actors became known for their ability to perform several characters at once, sometimes even on the same show. And networks could rerun children's animated programs more frequently than most live-action series due to the belief that children would not remember the original airings enough to lose interest. Negating any financial disadvantage, the experiment proved successful and the time slots were filled with profitable programming. Now, parents' lobbying groups such as Action for Children's Television began in the late 60s. They voiced concern over the presentation of commercialism, violence, antisocial attitudes, and stereotypes in Saturday morning cartoons. And by the 1970s, these groups exercised enough influence, especially in the United States Congress and the FCC, or the Federal Communications Commission, that the television networks felt compelled to impose more stringent content rules for the animation houses. By 1978, the Federal Trade Commission had openly considered a ban on all advertising during television programming targeting preschoolers and severe restrictions on other children's programming or program advertising, both of which would have effectively killed off the format. The commission ultimately dropped the proposals. The networks were encouraged to create educational spots that endeavored to use animation and/or live action for enrichment content, probably as a compromise between the advocacy groups on the one hand and the networks and the producers on the other.
Essentially gave us the He-Man type moral of the story at the end cartoon.
Yes. So He-Man was actually an after-school program as well as G.I. Joe. They also have these little bits at the end to satisfy these people. Well, all three of the networks decided that in addition to some of these bits that ran on the actual shows, they would do interstitial bits during the commercial breaks. So ABC went all in on this, and they actually did three different interstitial shows. They did Schoolhouse Rock, Time for Timer, and The Bod Squad. CBS had news segments called In the News, and they would show these little news where they would basically take the news and they would take out some of the violent and horrific content and then just show the other stuff. This is what's going on in the world. This is In the News. And it was pretty cool. NBC had a bit called Ask NBC News, but that didn't do really well. So they decided to do this show called One to Grow On. And One to Grow On would come on and have stars from other NBC shows. And they would just talk about something like, hey, this is why you should, brush your teeth, or this is why you should be nice to animals. And it's just these little interstitial bits with animation around their faces. Like, they would show the actual stars in a little animated television set, and there'd be animation going on around them. So all three of the big networks did this. But I want to mostly concentrate on talking about Schoolhouse Rock. Schoolhouse Rock is an American interstitial program series of animated musical education short films and later music videos that aired during Saturday morning children's programming on ABC. The theme cover covered included grammar, science, economics, history, mathematics, and civics. The series' original run lasted from 1973 to 1984. It was later revived from 93 to 96, and additional episodes were produced in 2009 for direct-to-video release. Now, when you guys were kids, I bought videos of this.
I remember the polar bear one where they're talking about the global warming and stuff. And
yes.
It was like, wow.
Those are some of the later ones, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They've done some a little more recently as well. But they're all out there. They're all available on Disney Plus. And I got you guys into them when you were little. And Lorelai likes them as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, you can go out and catch them all on Disney Plus. They're all out there. So the series idea was a guy by the name of David McCall. He was an advertising exec of McCaffrey and McCall who noticed his young son was struggling with learning his multiplication tables, despite being able to memorize the lyrics of many Rolling Stones songs. So McCall hired musician Bob Duro to write a song that would teach multiplication, which became Three is the Magic Number. Tom Yeo, an illustrator for at McCaffrey and McCall, heard the song and created a visual to accompany it, which they animated. Radford Stone, producer and writer at ABC, suggested they pitch it as a television series, which caught the attention of Michael Eisner, senior vice president in charge of programming and development at ABC. The cartoon director was Chuck Jones.
I gotta say, it's one of the very few good things that Mike Eisner has done.
Yeah, Schoolhouse Rock? Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, everything else when he was underneath Disney?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm with you. The first video of the series was Three is a Magic Number. It originally debuted during the debut episode of Curiosity Shop. What Curiosity Shop was in 1969, they started Sesame Street on PBS, and ABC wanted to get in on that game because they saw how wildly popular Sesame Street is. So ABC commissioned Chuck Jones to do a show for a few years that would compete with Sesame Street. And it would have stuff like this in it. Because, you know, Sesame Street's got a lot of little videos and stuff in it, right? It was called The Curiosity Shop. But Curiosity Shop only lasted a couple of years. I barely remember it because they would show it in reruns. Because I was born in 73. And occasionally I'd catch episodes of it on, like, a local channel where they'd rerun it. But Curiosity Shop was pretty cool. Anyway, so Schoolhouse Rock debuted as a series in January of 73 with Multiplication Rock, a collection of animated music videos adapting the multiplication tables to songs written by Bob Duro, and performed most of the songs, with Grady Tate performing two, Blossom Deary performing one during the seasons. General Foods was the series' first sponsor. Later sponsors of Schoolhouse Rock segments also included Nabisco, Kenner Toys, Kellogg's, and McDonald's. During the early 70s, Schoolhouse Rock was one of several short format animated educational shorts that aired on ABC's children's lineup. The others included Time for Timer, which I have included in our video. A lot of people thought that Time for Timer was actually part of Schoolhouse Rock, but it wasn't. Time for Timer was developed by DePatie Freleng. DePatie Freleng are the people that brought you Pink Panther and The Inspector and Tijuana Toads and yes, those guys. And the Bod Squad. Of the three, Schoolhouse Rock was the longest running. George Newell and Tom Yeo were the executive producers and creative directors of every episode, along with Bob Duro as musical director. The first season was followed in short order by a second season that ran from 73 to 75 entitled Grammar Rock, which included nouns, verbs, adjectives, and other parts of the speech, such as conjunctions.
Oh, yeah, conjunction, junction. What's your function?
Look at our phrases and clauses.
I love the fact that my teachers, even nowadays, will literally play these old Schoolhouse Rock songs because they still work.
Yeah.
They're still very good at teaching kids what a conjunction is.
When I was in third and fourth grade, we watched all of the math ones in math class because it helped us memorize that stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they did the parts of the speech. The show added the services of Jack Sheldon, a member of the Merv Griffin Show house band, as well as Lynn Ahrens. Both of them contributed to the series through the rest of its run. Blossom Deary returned for a second episode, and Ezra Mohawk joined the cast as a recurring singer. To coincide with the upcoming United States Bicentennial in 76, the third season was called American Rock, airing in 75 and 76. It had music videos covering the structure of United States government, such as I'm Just a Bill, which may be the most popular Schoolhouse Rock song.
It may be the most popular, but it never can beat Figure Eight.
Figure Eight. Oh, Figure Eight is beautiful. Along with the important moments in American history, examples include the preamble and Mother Necessity. A fourth series titled Science Rock followed in 78 and 79 and included a broad range of science-related topics. The first video of the season, A Victim of Gravity, parodied elements of the hit film Grease and featured a rare guest appearance from a pop band with recently reunited doo-wop group The Tokens provided the vocals. In addition to episodes described the human body's anatomical systems, the nervous, circulatory, skeletal, and digestive systems each received a music video. Episodes describing the physical science, such as astronomy, meteorology, and electricity, were also included, as was the Energy Blues, an environmentalist-themed video. So the science rock, that's where you get Interplanet Janet, which is one of my favorites. A fifth follow-up series titled Scooter, Computer, and Mr. Chips, featuring the titular characters, the only music video in the series to feature any recurring characters, premiered in the early 80s. And comprised just four segments about home computer technology, which was just emerging onto the scene. As the references depicted quickly became outdated due to the rapid advance of technology, i.e. Moore's Law, these segments stopped airing after 1985 and were not released on home video until a 30th anniversary DVD in 2002. Those are still around. You can see those on Disney Plus, and of course I think we've got the DVD set of them somewhere. But yeah, the the computer and Mr. Chips were they didn't run very long because all the stuff was outdated by the time they'd finished it. Another series they did was called Time for Timer. This is the one that was done, one of the ones that was done by DePatty at Freeling of Pink Panther fame. It was a series of seven short public service announcements broadcast on Saturday mornings on ABC. It started in 1975. The animated spot featured Timer, a tiny cartoon character who represents the sense of time in the human body. Timer was in charge of what a person felt. It was time to eat, time to sleep, etc. He carried a large pocket watch inside of him that set off an alarm whenever something was about to happen. Usually wearing a bow tie and a top hat, Timer looks like a little yellow meatball with a face and has long, slender arms and legs. Timer has limited magical powers such as teleportation, which he uses to exit his host's body from time to time. A wisecracker as well as a song and dance man, Timer promotes healthy eating and personal hygiene for children using clever songs and animation. Timer first appeared in the 73 ABC After School special, The Incredible, Inedible, Magical, Physical Mystery Trip, where he was voiced by Lynn Maxwell. And except for the 73 portrayal, Timer's voice was provided by actor Lenny Weinrib. Timer also appeared in the 1974 ABC After School special, The Magical Mystery Trip Through Little Red's Head, and in physical mystery trip, he worked inside the body of a man named Uncle Carl in Little Red. He worked inside a teenage Red Riding Hood. Time for Timer ran concurrently and interchangeably until 1992, when ABC's other educational spots, primarily The Bod Squad and Schoolhouse Rock. They generally appeared during cartoon programs at the end of commercial breaks. The shorts included a consultant credit for Dr. Rosalind B. Alphonslayer, UCLA School of Public Health. So Time for Timer, I always thought was part of Schoolhouse Rock. I did not realize until years later that it wasn't part of it, because it was used interchangeably. He's got one where he's like, if you get hungry, use a hunk of cheese. I got a hankering for a hunk of cheese. So he was like, look, take a cracker, put some cheese on it. You got a wagon wheel. It's just weird, man. But there's
Listen, I live in a house where there's not only one, but two ex-bartenders and theater people. And they're also the same people. So I know weird.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I literally live here.
That's true. So Time for Timer is awesome. And I've included some Time for Timer little episodes. They're only like 2 or 3 minutes long. The other series that ABC did was The Bod Squad. It's a series of short public service announcement broadcast on Saturday mornings on ABC, and it ran from 74 through 88. They were 30 seconds to 1 minute, and they promoted healthy nutrition and personal hygiene through humorous, animated, and catchy music with clever lyrics. The shorts were written by Lynn Ahrens and animated by, again, DePatty Freeling. These segments generally appeared at half-hour intervals interspersed with regular commercials. With many were not labeled as such. The first four segments ended with an announcement, another nutritional message from the ABC television network. An accompanying stock animation identified the series as the ABC Bod Squad. The same original segments produced in the 70s repeated every Saturday morning for several years, so that many, if not most, American TV-watching children during that period are familiar with them. Throughout the 70s and 80s, ABC broadcast several other series of educational public service cartoons. Again, Time for Timer and Schoolhouse Rocks. But most people didn't realize there were three different units that were doing these, because they all kind of blended together. One of the most famous Bod Squads was Exercise Your Teeth by the Choppers, which was like a doo-wop group. You know, that you want something for Chopper. You know, Chopper, yeah, that's me. You want to get some exercise. Exercise your teeth. Exercise your choppers with some good hard food. Exercise your choppers and some chew, chew, chew. And it's bizarre. But again, I've included Chopper on there.
Well, of course you're including Chopper.
In the YouTube page for this particular episode, Nerdery, or Just Nerdery, episode 2.
I
titled it Schoolhouse Rock because that's mostly what we're going to talk about. But I thought if we talked about Schoolhouse Rock, we got to talk about Time for Timer and the Bod Squad. One that was don't drown your food. If you got vegetables, don't drown them in ranch or whatever. It's a good one too.
Okay. I know don't drown your vegetables and ranch and stuff, but listen, a little bit of butter, a little bit of seasoning on some Brussels sprouts, and you can make, and then bake them in the oven.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
That's fucking delicious.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It is. It's exceptional. And yeah, a little bit of butter, a little bit of seasoning goes a long way. What this particular show was talking about, like people would just take like a carrot, and then just pour a whole bowl of, I'm assuming it's ranch. I think they call it dressing. Yeah. Over it. So yeah, don't drown your food. It goes a long way. Yeah. 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 Brussels sprouts need a little bit of butter. I get it. So yeah. CBS did their own. It was called In the News. In the News is an American series of 2-minute television video segments that summarize topical news stories for children and preteens. The segments were broadcast in the United States on CBS from 1971 to 1986. Um, which it was basically the idea was the same thing as Schoolhouse Rock. The micro series had its genesis in a series of animated interstitials produced by CBS and Hanna-Barbera called In the Know, featuring Josie and the Pussycats. They did those back in the 60s, narrating educational news segments tailored for children. There was eventually transformed into a more live-action-oriented microseries produced solely by the CBS News division called In the News. And the segments attempted to explain the essence of complex news stories to children and to do so in a way that might engage a young audience. Video clips of national or world events and special interest stories were shown with voiceover narration, specifically written with children in mind. Now, although news stories deemed to be inappropriate for children were not covered in the news, the series did feature a wide range of current events. And they didn't talk. It was like Schoolhouse Rock. They didn't talk down to kids. They just assumed that, you know, they'd take some of the more scary elements out. But it was like, this is what's going on in the world, and you guys need to know. And it was great. I've included, again, some of that stuff. It had a spinning globe that opened it. A lot of the Filmation stuff that I liked when I was a kid, like Jason of Star Command and the Super 7, all of that ran on CBS, and you'd have these little in the news breaks. But again, they were only about a minute long. On occasion, a special mini documentary segment in the future was presented, examining events and technology that may exist in the near future. Those were pretty cool. But it was all run by CBS News journalists, because again, they wanted to put that,
actually have some people who know what they're doing.
Yeah, and the animation houses obliged. They'd run bumpers for like, check out In the News, and you'd have Batman or the Robotic Stooges or Popeye or Mighty Mouse or Bugs Bunny announcing, next, another interesting story within the news. So they kind of incorporated it into the cartoon shows themselves. But yeah, In the News was pretty cool. Finally, we have one to grow on. It's an educational public service announcement that was broadcast during NBC's Saturday morning lineup from 83 to 89. Now, NBC got into this late. Because Schoolhouse Rock started in the early 70s, as well as Time for Timer, Bod Squad. In the News started in 1971. So NBC really was the last holdout to doing these. But what they did was the segments were hosted by stars of their primetime shows, like Michael J. Fox, Michael Gross, and Justine Bateman for Family Ties, Mr. T and Dwight Schultz from the A-Team.
The idea of Mr. T telling you, come on, kids, that's not right.
Don't deal with bullies.
Exactly.
It was awesome. Soleil Moon Frye from Punky Brewster, David Hasselhoff from Knight Rider, as well as Kit.
They got the fucking car?
Yes. Yes, they did. Kim Fields, Dancy McKeon, Lisa Welchel, and Charlotte Ray from The Facts of Life, and Richard Mull from Night Court. As well as Michael and Jamal Warner and Tempest Bledsoe from The Cosby Show, Perry King and Thomas Bray from Riptide, which we've talked about before, Joel Higgins and Rick Schroeder from Silver Spoons, Kadeem Hardison from A Different World, Jackie Harris from 227, Estelle Getty and Betty White from The Golden Girls. I've included one of the Betty White ones in our playlist. It is awesome. But again, what they would do is they'd have this little birthday cake with these candles, because that was the thing. You'd have, you know, if you were turning 10, you had 10 candles plus an extra one for one to grow on. And it would morph into these kids talking and eating ice cream. And then it would morph into this television screen, and the star would appear in the television screen. And then they'd show little stuff on what they were talking about, and they would start talking. But the animation was around the star's head the whole time.
It sounds very trippy, almost like it does belong in the 70s, though.
Yeah, I know. But yes. Yeah, I do. But it was mostly done with what would appear to be like line drawings and watercoloring. So it had a very 1980s feel to it. But again, it was NBC got into it late to the game, but they kind of brought some power to it. The one to grow on was pretty cool. Many of the celebrities featured were from sitcoms, other shows kids were not familiar with, like Rene Enriquez from the adult-oriented primetime show Hill Street Blues also hosted a segment specifically on how children should not watch his TV show since it was broadcast too late past their bedtime.
Which is kind of funny.
Yeah.
Kid, what are you watching? How do you know me? That's not right.
Pro athlete Ozzie Smith did a one that was revolved around the issue of using snuff, where Smith explained to his segment that he is not a user of snuff and has nothing to do at all with baseball playing ability or the image of the big leagues because he was a baseball player. And of course, Nancy Reagan did the Just Say No campaign. Yeah. Jaleel White, another child actors also did it. And at the end, they would end it with, and that's one to grow on. One to grow on received an Emmy Award in 1987. But they stopped doing it. They were like, because the animation kind of got old. Because again, like you said, it was kind of trippy in the 70s, but done in 80s colors. But by 1989, it was tired. So they did a new one called The More You Know. And you've seen The More You Know. It's in memes. The star with the rainbow behind it that says The More You Know.
Yeah.
Okay, they started running those in 1989. And they would have like Tom Brokaw or I know there's an Ed Asner one I think I've included, which I always thought was really great.
I love Ed Asner. Rest in peace.
Mm-hmm.
I do love usually during the interviews, he'd be like, hi, I'm Ed Asner, and pull out like a pocket knife and open it. And it's like, he's threatening me.
Yeah. Ed Asner is awesome. But yeah, that's basically it for Schoolhouse Rock. Other than these things are incredible, they're out there. You can go and check our YouTube playlist to see a bunch of examples of these. I've included several Schoolhouse Rock, the Bod Squad, Time for Timer. All of the Schoolhouse Rock stuff is available on Disney Plus now, including the ones they stopped showing because they were antiquated.
Out of date.
Yeah. But I'm hoping someone picks up the Time for Timer, Bod Squad, and some of the other ones like One to Grow On. They are all out on YouTube, and I've grabbed several examples. But yeah, that's about it for Schoolhouse Rock. Thanks for going on that trip with me.
Yeah, no problem.
Excellent. So that'll about wrap it up for our Just Nerdery episode, Just Nerdery episode 2, while we're on hiatus. K3's has agreed to do some of these with me, so I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Of course.
Again, to our Patreons, thank you again so much for sticking with us and keeping our show up, because it still costs to put this stuff out. You can always go to our YouTube page and look at our playlist for every single episode. We've got stuff where we talked about. I usually put those up before the episode comes out, so if you want to look at them beforehand and see how that works, that's fine too. So again, with that, I have been Zig with your Just Nerdery.
And I'm Kim with your Internery.
Cue the music.
That's me doing music.